your mark. Get set. Go! Send them over there.
Ah, there's nothing like fresh squeezed fruit to get you going in the morning. But one of these two teams is going to put the squeeze on 25 bananas and control of the game, while the other one is just going to get wrung out.
Closer to that line, but now the red team is moving fast and furious. You may want to move some of those sponges out of the way after you use them. It's certainly your choice. Keep sitting on them, and who's going to get past that line first? Looks perhaps like the blue team did it. The blue team did it right over here. You can stop right there. We have a winner. Let's go play some Family Double Dare.
It's Family Double Dare. And now, here's your Family Double Dare host, someone who can hit the open man on the give and go every time, Marc Summers.
And it is our pleasure here on the Screen Squad podcast to bring on television personality. You guys all remember him, Marc Summers. Marc, how's it going? How's your summer going? No pun intended. Everything going well for you, my man?
It's good. You know, lots of travel, East Coast to West Coast, and a lot of stuff in between, and just working and having fun as always.
Well, you got to L.A. in 1973. Double Dare didn't come about till 1986. So what'd you do in those 13 years? Did you ever have moments of doubt making it?
I got up one day. I had lunch. I was doing a lot of stuff. I started off as a page at CBS Television City, working on shows like Carol Burnett, All in the Family, Mary Tyler Moore, Sonny and Cher, and then, you know, slowly worked my way up. I was a writer on a show called Truth or Consequences, which was a show that Bob Barker did before Price is Right. I started doing warm-ups on television shows. I was working at a place called The Magic Castle. Then I started as a regular at the Comedy Store in 1976, working along guys like, you know, Leno and Letterman and Robin Williams, Gary Shandling, folks like that. We all started about the same time. And so I was just working it, you know, just trying to make a living in the entertainment business, and didn't get the audition for Double Dare until the summer of 86, and got the job over Labor Day of 86, and that changed my life, and the rest is history, you know?
Let's talk a little bit about that, because, you know, when it came to Double Dare, I think it was a friend of yours that was going to audition but said you should go. Over 2,000 people auditioned for this, and they were going to offer it, I think, to Dana Carvey, but it winds up being you. I mean, how did that process work out for you, and just kind of go through that kind of moment, because what a great situation that was and turned out to be for you.
It was. A friend of mine, Dave Garrison, who was a ventriloquist, we both grew up in Indianapolis, was out here in L.A. working with me from time to time on stuff, and he decided he wanted to get behind the scenes and become more of a producer, and got the phone call from the Nickelodeon folks. At the time, you know, Nickelodeon was, you know, in my head a little bit because I had small children, and I used to wake up at 3 in the morning for feedings, and there was a thing called Pinwheel on, and that's kind of all I knew about Nickelodeon. And he said they were getting ready to do a game show called Double Dare, and I went in and auditioned and thought I did a great job and got a bunch of callbacks, and eventually flown to New York and got the job after they looked at about 2,000 people in New York and 1,000 people in L.A. And yes, they were offering the job, I guess, to Dana Carvey, so the story goes. But the same week, he got an offer to do a little show called Saturday Night Live. And so he took that, lucky for him and lucky for me. And it was quite an interesting process. You know, I had been writing game shows for a number of years and been helping produce some things as far as run-throughs and things like that in the office, nothing really solid on television. So I had a background in game shows, and everybody who was forming this show at Nickelodeon really had zero background in it. They just knew that they wanted to try and do it. They had done focus groups and found out that kids were living vicariously through watching their parents watch Price is Right and shows like that. And there was never a game show for kids at the time, so right time, right place, it happened. I was the right guy, apparently. I connected with the kids, and, you know, it put Nick on the map, it put me on the map.
Well, what's your relationship with Pauly Shore like? We got to ask this. We noticed during Double Dare, you took a few jabs his way during some of the questions. So.
Pauly Shore, poor boy. You know, his mother and father ran a place called the Comedy Store where I got my early feet wet in entertaining. And I never got Pauly. You know, he played that strange character back in the heyday of Double Dare. And I'm pretty vocal about if I like things and if I don't. And I would always sort of goof on him. So, you know, do I have a lot of respect for his talent? Not really. And so I would voice it on those shows, but I would also voice my opinion about Elvis and everything else. And it if you got the little side joke, great, because most of the kids who were watching were between, you know, 8 and 12, maybe 8 and 14, and sometimes they'd understand my sense of humor and sometimes they didn't, but it didn't get in the way of the show, and the parents would stop me and say, you know, I watch every day for that one thing you do for us, because I was mostly trying to entertain the parents as well.
Well, Mark, you know, there's kind of a maybe a misconception out there that that you really didn't enjoy your time on Double Dare because of...
The fact that people say that,
right.
You know? Because it was the best time I ever had from 86 to 94. This thing about me having OCD is blown out of proportion. Did and do I have it? Absolutely. But, you know, I loved every day going to work. I had the best time. If you talk to Mike Klinghoffer and Dana Calderwood and Alan Silverberg, our producers and writers, there was never a day that wasn't the best day of our lives. And so all that stuff should be put to bed. There was never a bad day on the set of Double Dare, ever, you know.
Well, how are you able to control those feelings on such a messy show that going on? We know after the show you ran to the showers, but how'd you control that during the show?
Well, you know what? All I ever wanted to be was on television. So, I mean, I was living the dream and was able to overcome. I mean, the best, we did five of those a day, sometimes six. The best time was when those cameras rolled and we were playing television. And so I was able to, you know, to do what I did. I hadn't been diagnosed. I knew that there was something a little strange and unusual, that I was, you know, sort of a neat freak. And, you know, people say I'm a germaphobe. I was never a germaphobe. I just didn't like getting messy. And here I was on the messy show on television. So it's a matter of mind over matter and overcoming stuff. And I was able to do it. And I, you know, I defy, as I always say, anybody to look at one episode and, you know, feel like I'm not having a good time. I'm always screwing around, having the best time of my life. So, you know, the internet is a lovely and a horrible thing at the same time. People who are morons, who have, you know, no right to say anything, start spewing stuff that isn't true. And no matter how many times you put it up online and say, you know, this guy doesn't know what the hell he's talking about, people seem to hang their hats on it. And, you know, go fight City Hall. There's more important things in life than that.
Yeah, definitely. In 98, you come out admitting that you do have OCD. You kind of find out by a guest that's on Summers and Biggers there. Biggers and Summers.
Biggers and Summers. I wish it was Summers and Biggers, but it was Biggers and Summers.
Did you guys have any fights about that over who's going to go first?
No, I was the only guy on an all-women's network. You know, Lifetime was television for women at the time, and I was the only male host. So even though I had many more years experience than Sissy Biggers, it was Biggers and Summers, and I kind of had to eat it. But I was making considerably more money than her, so it was easy to swallow.
Well, after to admitting that you get let go from Hollywood Squares and Biggers and Summers, stories coming out that you're crazy, whatnot. So how do you look back on that?
Yeah, I was crazy. There I go. You know, what happened was everything gets, you know, bent out of shape and out of proportion. You know, somehow Howie Mandel's gotten a pass his whole life for having OCD, and everybody started to claim that I was insane. So, you know, it was difficult at first. You know, I was one of the first people to come on and talk about this stuff. I suppose if I did it now, there wouldn't be as much hubbub. But, you know, maybe it was the Nickelodeon thing. Who knows why it was and what it was. But, yeah, it kind of put a halt to my career for a while. And luckily I was able to overcome it. But, you know, for some reason it was not a good part of my time, you know, in the industry.
Well, we got to ask you about the incident on The Tonight Show with Jay Leno. Burt Reynolds is there as well. You make there's a little banter going back and forth, and you get some water dumped on you.
Yeah, that was an interesting thing. At the time, I was hosting four different shows on TV, and my publicist at the time was trying to get me on, and they handled Jason Alexander as well, and Seinfeld was hot, and The Tonight Show wanted Jason on as a regular, and the deal was, and that's how deals are made in L.A., they said, well, if you want Jason, we'll give him to you, but you got to, you know, put Marc Summers on The Tonight Show. So they interviewed me, and they said yes, and, you know, all this time went by, and I kept getting booked and then canceled and booked and then canceled, and the day it finally happened on our way there, the limo that picked me up had got a flat tire, and we're stuck on the Ventura Freeway, and I was like, you know, what the hell? How am I ever going to get on this program? And everybody seemed to think it was set up, and it was not. Bert was having a hard time because he was going through a divorce with Lonnie Anderson. He was angry and hostile, and he was only supposed to do two segments, and he was doing so well they gave him three. And backstage are me and Carrot Top. And they go, you know, who do I put on? Which guy who nobody knows should I put on, Summers or Carrot Top? And so they were going to bounce me, and the publicist said, to the producer of The Tonight Show, if you bounce Summers, no more Jason Alexander. So they put me on, and it was one of the best moments ever for me on TV, because Bert was in a pissy mood, and we got into a conversation, and Jay was asking me questions, and he said, I said something about being a neatness fanatic. He said, "Who said you're a neatness fanatic?" And I said, "My wife, and by the way, I'm still married." And he picked up a glass of water, unbeknownst to me, and dropped it in my crotch, and when I tried to, you know, counterattack, he straight-armed me, and a porcelain cup went into my face. I thought he broke a tooth, and, you know, and from there it was pies and more water and craziness. And, you know, the next day on the New York papers, it said, "Bert goes berserk on Tonight," and I'm being interviewed by every major newspaper and Entertainment Tonight and Howard Stern and Access Hollywood and God knows what else. And, you know, it was great. And to this day, people stop me and say, you know, "I saw you on with Bert. Was that set up or not?" I said, "I'm not that good of an actor. It just was what it was." And so, you know, my one moment on the Tonight Show was, you know, somewhat sensationalized and is used often when Jay would do the anniversary shows. They'd show that clip. So, you know, a little place in history, but not the way I wanted to do it with Johnny, which would have been better, and B, not the way I wanted to stand up. But, you know, certainly you remember it.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And, Mark, and you know, you're off TV for 3 years, and you end up calling the woman who let you go, who was now with the Food Network, which I find that, you know, a very interesting story there, and kind of, you know, wound up connecting with her. And after 3 years, what made you pick up that phone and make that call and, you know, trying to get back into, you know, onto a show like that?
Well, you know, Bigger Than Summers was canceled. I moved back to Los Angeles. And for some reason, I couldn't get arrested. You know, the whole OCD thing was, you know, he's difficult to work with, and he's a pain in the butt, and all that stuff. It's like, you know, I don't know where that stuff came from. And so I had been, by that time, properly diagnosed with OCD and was on a medication called Luvox and became the spokesperson for Solvay Pharmaceuticals going around the country talking to people who had OCD and trying to get them help. So that was a positive thing. And then I wrote a book called Everything in Its Place. And, you know, after 3 years of that, I was like, gee, I want to get back on TV. And Judy Girard, who was the lady who fired me at Lifetime because the ratings weren't good on Bigger Than Summers, became the head of programming at Food Network. And I called her up and I said, "Judy, I'll pay you to get me back on TV." And she gave me a show called It's a Surprise, about surprise parties, and the surprise was nobody was watching. But they did a focus group and found out that through some specials of Unwrapped that were on, that people liked the show, but they liked me as a host, and so they figured if they married me with the program, maybe something would happen. And, you know, it's now the longest running show on Food Network. We're also on Cooking Channel. We're now in a spinoff called Rewrapped. And, you know, I never had, you know, any qualms about picking up the phone and saying, you know, put me in this position, give me a job. If you're shy, show business is not the place for you. You got to ask for what you want. You got to tell people what you want. If you sit in a room, you know, I always say, I lecture to colleges and a lot of different groups, and my opening line is, nobody got up this morning and said, "I got to go find Marc Summers a job today." You know, nobody really cares about me or you or anybody else. It's up to you to get up every morning and make things happen. And so picking up the phone was easy.
Can you talk about your success with the Food Network? Shows like you mentioned, Unwrapped, now Rewrapped, Restaurant Impossible. What all that means to you after your journey to this point?
Well, you know, I never had any desire to be on the Food Network. I just wanted to work on television. And if somebody would have told me after being at Nickelodeon for 8 years that I'd be somewhere else longer, you know, I've been at Food Network for 15 years. I mean, first as talent with Unwrapped, and then we did Trivia Unwrapped, and then I hosted the first 2 years of Next Food Network Star, and I did a show with Fieri called Ultimate Recipe Showdown, and then I started exec producing First Dinner Impossible and Restaurant Impossible, and I've been able to jump back and forth. Sometimes I'm in front, sometimes I'm behind, but it's been the best relationship I've ever had. I love the job, I love the people I work with, I love this whole new world of culinary. You know, rock stars, one thing, is chefs have become rock stars now, and it's just a good world to be in. My son started working with me, now he's off on his own, he's exec producing Cutthroat Kitchen, so we kind of kept it in the family, and I can't think of a better job than what I'm doing now.
Well, is there anything in the works that might find you hosting again? I know you may prefer doing that over doing the producing, and of course we all, you know, would love to see you back out in front. That's kind of where Marc Summers belongs, at least in our opinion here.
Well, you know, I'd like to. They're not hiring, you know, guys my age who look like me much as hosts on television anymore. You pretty much have to have tattoos and piercings and stuff like that and be, you know, 28.
Not too late.
Seacrest is even too old at this point, I think. But, you know, who knows? When they asked me to come back and do Rewrapped as a head judge, I was happy to do it. Is somebody going to offer me another show? I think the odds are slim and none, but, you know, stranger things have happened. And can I still do it? No question. question about it. I just hosted the 100th anniversary show of Restaurant Impossible, and thought it came off, you know, pretty darn good. So the chops are still there. It's just somebody picking up the phone and, you know, making the offer. But look, my life is a pretty charmed existence. I always feel like I've never worked a day in my life. I always say, let's get up every morning and go play TV. And, you know, I'm doing a couple of pilots for Food Network. I'm doing a special for Discovery. We continue with Restaurant Impossible, rewraps, shooting 13 new episodes. I'm not doing a lot of personal appearances again. So, you know, I have zero complaints, trust me.
What about Broadway? We know you have dreams of playing Broadway. You've had some opportunities. You missed out on some auditions with Mel Brooks, the producers. You had the role for Tom Hanks in Big. Didn't quite show up to those. So, do you have any plans?
Yeah, a couple
doing
times
that?
I was too nervous to go to these auditions, but I am actually. I can't give away too much, but I'm auditioning for a major Broadway show in the next 4 to 6 weeks, and working on the music and dialogue as we speak, and also in the process of having a one-man show written, and we hope to have that up on its feet by February of next year. So, yeah, I still have some strong desires to go in that direction, and we'll have to see where it goes, but it's always fun to put yourself in a dangerous situation and make yourself uncomfortable, and certainly that would do that to me, that's for sure.
Well, you know, we talked about some of the things you're up to now, but there's a few more shows you're working on. Can you get into some of those for some of our listeners that may want to check you out on Marriage Impossible, Kitchen Ambush, and for HGTV, we got Renovation Impossible, all coming up, all very exciting.
Well, we got the two they're working on right now is a show called Fitness Impossible for Food Network, where Robert's going to talk about health and fitness and exercise with the viewers, and then I'm doing another special with Robert and Gary Sinise, where we're going to take a soldier and redo his place, and we're excited to be, you know, paying back to the military who do so much for us, and a few other things in the works I can't talk about, but it's always busy. There's never a dull moment. I mean, I get up every day, and, you know, one minute I'm in New York, then I'm in Philly, then I'm in Los Angeles. Last week I was in Park City, Utah. I mean, who knows? It's just, you know, I just enjoy my life, and I've been able to find a career that, you know, is just so much entertainment for me all the time because it's different, you know. If I had to get up every day and go to an office and do the same thing, I'd probably blow my brains out, but I've been lucky enough to find a job that, you know, is so varies in so many different ways on a daily basis, so it's all good.
Well, Mark, I'll tell you what, it's so great to catch up with you today. I mean, it's so awesome to talk to you, someone that entertained us so much as younger children, and to know that you're still in the industry, still doing what you love to do. It's amazing, and you've just been such a great guest. We can't thank you enough, man. I hope you have a wonderful rest of the summer, and definitely hope to catch up down the road, man. Hope everything's going well.
That would be good, and I'm applauding you guys. You did some great homework here, and you didn't ask the same questions I get asked over and over, so I'm very pleased, and congratulations. Nice job,
yeah,
guys.
Well, we personally watched every interview on YouTube that you did. We didn't want to ask the same questions, so... And we're looking forward to a buddy comedy movie with you and Pauly Shore coming out soon.
Yes.
So. Amazing. Hey, you guys have a great day. Thanks so much.
Summer, Marc Summers, thanks a lot, man. Thank you so much.
Take care.
All right, be well. Bye-bye.
$1,200.
Thanks for being with us on Family Double Dare. Did you have a good time, Candace?
Yeah.
How about you, Jaleel?
Oh, I had a great time.
I'm so glad to hear it. We always have a good time here on Family Double Dare. This family runs away with lots of cash, lots of prizes. Join us every Saturday and Sunday night on Nickelodeon 7:30. We'll see you soon. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.